Hi everyone, welcome to another interesting episode of India AI Conversations. Today we have a very interesting speaker joining us, Mr. Gaurav Kataria. He is the Chief Digital and Information Officer at Sai Life Sciences Limited. He has worked previously with as a Vice President for Digital Strategy Solutions at Cyient, focusing on aerospace and defense. He is a man with decades of experience under his belt in digital transformation, and he is today going to talk to us about the role of AI in pharmaceutical industry, and especially the role AI is going to play in development of the COVID vaccine as well as the distribution of the COVID vaccine, which is going to be a huge landmark moment in our lifetime.
So Gaurav, we have seen AI playing a crucial role in the pandemic period. For example, I think a few days back, PricewaterhouseCoopers released a report which says there has been a huge increase in AI adoption in India. And across the world, you know, McKinsey was pointing out that healthcare and pharma has been the major driver for AI adoption in 2020. I mean, not surprising considering the circumstances we are living in.
Correct.
So, what is the role of AI in pharma? I mean, for the people who are completely new to this industry.
Right. So that's an interesting question, Viju. And I think a lot of people that I talk to, don't have clarity around where AI can be applied, right? There are a lot of usual use cases, that people look at in other industries, but pharma is a little different. And the reason why it's different is because it's also highly regulated. Right, as an industry. But the interesting piece in pharma is that every part of the value chain in pharma, right from drug discovery all the way to manufacturing large scale compounds or molecules or drugs, generate a lot of data. And where there is data, there is an application of AI, or I'll say machine learning to start with, and then AI, which is possible, right? So right across, so if you see even the cycles of drug discovery, right from identifying new molecules to improving your clinical trials which come out, right? All of those, both of those areas, and then you go down, to scaling up, to actually getting into the manufacturing process, AI can be applied at every stage, right? So there is a lot of uptake which is happening from an AI perspective, and we'll talk more as we go forward, but even in this, pandemic situation where, the drugs have come out, and we have the first one, Pfizer getting approved in UK, and many of the others which are in pipeline, has been made possible because there is a huge amount of technology which is being used to accelerate the whole process.
So you mentioned about pharmaceutical being one of the most regulated industries, and of course it's for a reason.
Sure.
So do you think apart from that, what are the major challenges for a pharmaceutical organization to deploy AI?
It's been a traditional industry, right? The pharmaceutical industry. And the industry has evolved, which also means that in a lot of cases, the basic data acquisition systems, are not in place. Like, for example, there are still pharmaceutical organizations, big as well as small, which use something that we call a lab notebook, which is to document all the experiments, right? And that is still done on pen and paper. But there are some advanced companies who are making the investments of going into something called an electronic lab notebook. Now, once you have an electronic lab notebook, all your data is digitized. And with that data, you can start doing, applying machine learning or artificial intelligence to start deriving insights out of it, right? So that's an example where, the industry is transforming from being a traditional industry to a very, very highly advanced industry, because everybody is seeing the benefits of applying technology at every part of the process, right? So the drug discovery process itself, or the clinical trial process, right? So when you get a report from the clinical trials, right, These could be, you know, you could be doing, or even before that, when you're doing experiments and in vivo or in vitro, in both of those cases as well, there's a lot of data which is generated. A lot of the places this data is still manually captured, but then there are advanced systems where people are starting to use to capture all that data digitally so that it can be synthesized and analyzed at the end of the day, and then application of AI. So from a challenge perspective, I won't really call it a challenge. I think it's an opportunity for people to really transform from being paper-based to more digital so that the technologies can be applied to really create an impact.
I was remembering this famous quote by Winston Churchill, you know, in 1940, during the midst of World War II, he said, never let a good opportunity goes to, you know, a good crisis goes to waste. And when he said that quote, he meant that it's an opportunity to rethink the structure, reanalyze and reconfigure. And I think that's something that has been happening during this COVID period, right? Many industries, when you look at the adoption rate, surprisingly, hospitality and travel industry is the most to adopt AI in India in the last few months. So I completely agree to your point, you know, why traditional industries, you know, like pharma and others has to transform and adapt during, especially during this period and going forward. Speaking about something, I you know, something that's been all over the news right now is the vaccines that's been working. You have the Covaxin, COVID Shield, you have the Sputnik, you know, everything is in the news. So I would like to ask you, what are your thoughts on those vaccines? You know, how much role AI would have played in their development and trials? Or do you think going forward we can eliminate such things as clinical trials through AI simulation or something like that?
See, I'll answer the last question first, right? Can you eliminate clinical trials? I don't think we can. I don't think also we should. Because at the end of the day, you know, while the AI engines really help you improve and reduce the time of clinical trials, and that's one of, you know, this is a great example, you know, the COVID vaccine. Typically, if you see a new drug entry into the market, it is nearly an 8 to 10 year process, right? The only way that 8 to 10 year process has been crunched to less than a year now, or maybe a year now, is because of the application of technology, and AI has a big role to play in that with all the data which is coming out, analysis of data and stuff like that. Now, does this mean that this can be done effectively for every drug? Maybe not, because the complication of the drug or the disease that you're trying to eradicate or solve, the problem that you're trying to solve, can be far more complex, right? So it depends on case to case basis. But this is COVID vaccine, is a great example where we've seen that the time's getting crunched from a money perspective as well, right? It takes nearly about $2.5 billion to create a new drug, right? I don't know the figures right now for the COVID vaccine on how much they've spent, but I'm sure with the application of AI and the application of technology per se at every part of the process, right, from, like I said, drug discovery all the way down to manufacturing, you know, there are a lot of efficiencies which can be gained in the overall life cycle, right, which really, really help. Clinical trials, you know, we should continue to do those. We have to make sure that every drug that comes out in the market, is safe for the user and is effective as well. So the efficacy and safety are really, really critical, and those cannot be compromised at any point of time.
So since we're speaking about drugs and the vaccines, what is your thoughts on how, you know, with the widespread adoption of AI and other data-driven technologies, how can we be better prepared for a next pandemic like this?
See, pandemics, this is a rare occurrence, right? If you look at it, the kind of pandemic that we are in at a scale at which we are in, right? But having said that, you know, can we be well prepared? Absolutely. I think there are a couple of things which are required, right, for that to really happen. There has to be a global sort of a consortium. There are many, and there is a lot of data available, in public domain, through paid or unpaid access, where there is information being shared. But as we start getting more and more digital, companies start getting digital, the government start getting digital, because then the health patient record starts getting digital. You have more and more data coming in to start spotting places where you start seeing certain occurrences of disease or spread, you know, which can then create, parabolic effect across the nation or worldwide, that can start being tracked. So there are a lot of people working on predictive models, you know, like you typically do in a manufacturing scenario, predictive maintenance. Similarly, there are predictive models being created across the globe to try and see how we can, judge the spread, right? And also, try and catch some of the pandemics which are going to happen a little earlier, right? At least start seeing that. But then at the end of the day, this is nature, right? Or, in some cases, it could be out of a reaction coming out of, an adverse effect that has happened in a process, right? Now, in both of these cases, it becomes very, very difficult to predict, right? So the best of AI algorithms, if you actually also go to neural networks and deep learning and things like that, there is a possibility to, nip it at the bud. But at the end of the day, it's going to be very difficult to really completely eradicate. But will the process be shorter? Will it be better and easier to control? Absolutely.
So one another thing that has been happening, if you look at the AI ecosystem in India, so many startups coming into the healthcare sector, and they have been doing a fantastic job, especially in democratizing many of the screening process. What is your thought on how AI can create a positive impact in India's healthcare system? Do you believe it can bring down the cost? Do you believe it can, accessibility? How do you envision the healthcare sector moving forward with more AI incorporated?
So I think that's a good question, Jibu. And I think that's also the need of the hour, right? So one side is the actual vaccine drug discovery, process of getting new medicines to the market. The other side is the healthcare, right? Now, which is actually the application of these drugs in the market. Now, I totally agree with you that the startup ecosystem is doing a great job, right? My only, advice to them is, pick out a problem statement which doesn't only look, quote unquote sexy, but it also solves a real problem. As long as you're able to find a problem statement which solves a real problem, right, of making sure that, not only that the drug is administered, but also the efficacy of the drug, right, the outreach of the drug, making sure that everybody at the last mile gets the drug, right, is going to really create an impact. Now, if you see, and we are in a situation where we are talking about COVID and, this is on top of mind, but even when the drug comes in, we have the vaccine available, let me put it that way. Delivery of the vaccine itself is going to be a major challenge across the Indian population, right? Making sure that every nook and corner of India gets this and everybody has access to the vaccine itself is going to be a challenge. So if AI can be applied and if technologies, different technology can be applied, it could be tracing and tracking, it could be, technologies, that can be applied. That will really create a far-reaching impact to make sure that the vaccine is administered properly and in a timely manner to everybody across, India. And then likewise, if you scale that up across the globe, right? So there are a lot of applications, but then you have to select the problem statement and then go after that to really solve the problem.
I completely am very much surprised by the insight you provided, right? In many of the let's say layman's thoughts, the application of AI stops where you do a drug discovery or stops where you create a vaccine, right? But the bigger picture there on the distribution, there are many demographics you have to consider, the democratic, the profession, making the healthcare workers available vaccine as soon as possible opposed to other groups. So there are a lot of factors that has to go in, and the role of data is going to be much more than I anticipated until you just explained it to me.
Absolutely, right? Because finally you have to look at the complete ecosystem, right? the only way the pharma ecosystem will, or the healthcare and pharma ecosystem will evolve is, right, when you start looking at the complete ecosystem. So you're not only looking at that one laboratory or one R&D center which is trying to do a drug discovery, or that one manufacturing unit which is superbly digitized to, you know, give you a great product. Because what AI will also helps do is make sure that we are compliant. So compliances and safety, become paramount in the healthcare industry. And that is sort of kept under check and balance when you with the right application of AI. But it's also the ecosystem around it. So there are so many sort of small labs. There are pathology labs which are there, right? Then there are clinics which are sort of administering the drug. There's that complete supply chain in the middle which has to carry the drug from one place to the other, right? If you start looking at it, I'll give you one example, right? If you want to transfer a drug or a vaccine, let's say from one of the manufacturing facilities to a village, there is a cold chain which needs to be maintained, right, to keep the drug at the right temperature. Now, how can you really put sensors and technology on top of it that those are tracked, and any degradation of quality or the ambient temperature is then captured, right? And that can then feed back into an AI model to say that during this certain time of the year, right, with so much such weather conditions or pollution levels, you can do a lot of triangulation of data, right? Finally, this is what we need to do. So while the prescribed norm is to keep, let's say, a temperature at, -2 degrees Celsius, I'm just picking up some random thought. But in that specific area, when I'm delivering it to a certain kind of a zone, certain kind of location, it should be kept at -4, right? That should be the threshold. And anything below -4, as it sort of goes up above -4, it should give an alarm that, there's something wrong, because the ambient temperature, the pollution levels, etc., are not really conducive to that environment. So there's a lot of application that can be done right from beginning all the way to the end. But and that's what these startups can do, because they are detached from the process. If I'm with a pharmaceutical organization, I'm with my, to a certain extent with my blinders on, right? And I'm focused on delivering the best quality product for whatever I am doing. But then the entire ecosystem, that's where the startups have a great opportunity to look at from a broader perspective without the blinders on.
I think, like you said, I think the key thing here is to identify the right problems and applying the technology. And, this has been very insightful. So how do you say, how can we increase the role of, AI, more adoption of AI in pharmaceutical and healthcare? Do you think there is a requirement of skilling there, proper need for more skilled, employees, or upskilling the current employees? How can we solve this gap between the potential of applying AI and the current what we have done?
Right. So talent is definitely a challenge today, right? Even when I talk to teams which are AI of teams of AI experts, let me put it that way, right? There is one set of people who are really, really good from a data science perspective. Right, they know the algorithms, they know the data science, they know the modeling. Then there is another set of people that you require, which is more the analyst kind of community, which is probably not the data science, but then they are really good with data per se. So which is the data prep layer. Sometimes what happens is we miss the data prep, and hence the data scientists can't really do the magic that person is intended to do, because the quality of data itself is weak. Right, which goes back to the fundamental problem, like I was saying earlier, is data capture and data governance becomes important. Right now, so if you see right from data capture as a mechanism, be it through sensors or be it like the electronic lab notebook example that I gave you, right, to all the way down to data prep, all the way down to applying data science and models on top of it, right? So this is one stream. The second stream which has to come together is of the domain experts. People who really understand the pharmaceutical industry and understand the problem statement, right? Understand the finer nuances, right? What is the difference between an in vitro and an in vivo, what are the different experiments that need to be done? While the data coming out, these might look similar, right? But the actual the impact of that data or the understanding of the data will only come to somebody who understands the pharmaceutical industry or the data or the scientist actually within the laboratory, not the data scientist, but the scientist within the laboratory, right? Now, both of these streams, which is the pharma or the healthcare stream and the technology stream, which is the data science layer, has to sort of come together, right? Till the time they both don't come together, you can't really create the impact that you want. So, and finding one person with that talent, who is, let's say, a doctor by education, right, but a data scientist by qualification, education versus qualification, right, is very, very rare, right? And that is where lies the problem, right? So a lot of companies, what they're trying to do is they're trying to blend both of these together and create harmonized teams or heterogeneous teams coming together to solve this problem, right? But then there is obviously Chinese whispers between both of these, but lots more that needs to be done. So once these teams have to come together and both of these are expensive resources, right, then, you know, the problem statement solution becomes more expensive, becomes less affordable, and you know that becomes a problem. Coming back to your question on education, absolutely, I think more and more people need to get educated around the impact that data analytics can have at the fundamental level and going all the way up to AI and AI applications. What that will do, and that has to happen to the scientist community who are actually working in the labs. And what will that help is whenever they spot a problem, they will have their antennas up and they will put that hat of a data scientist. While they might not understand the modeling, which is fine, but at least the data analytics and an AI 101 is really, really important for them to start, have the ability to start spotting a problem and a possible application. Let them bring that up within their organization to the right department, which could be the office of the data officer or chief data officer or whatever, or the chief digital officer office, or anybody else, so that then we can then put the teams together to actually identify if it's a genuine problem which can be solved, a genuine use case which has the merit to apply AI on it, and then take it forward. So from that perspective, 2-3 levels of training which are important. One is an AI 101, which should be broad-based across, not only limited to people who want to get into this profession, but, scientists who are actually working on drug discovery, or manufacturing engineers who are actually running the shop floors, actually. So everybody should get covered with that. The second level is your data scientists who have to understand the pharma industry that they're getting into. So they need a pharma 101. Right, or a 102, a little next advanced level, so that they understand that nuances. And then third is actually building the data scientists, right? But right from data prep, which is the data analyst layer, which is preparing the data, because that is a critical part of the whole process, because garbage in is garbage out at the end of the day, right? And then finally the data scientists. So there are 3-4 levels where we have to start training people to really get this whole thing together.
That's very insightful. So essentially, we are speaking the future belongs to people who are sort of, bilinguals, who has this multiple domain expertise. I come across this cases in agriculture more often, by how the engineers or the data or the analytical folks often miss out many of the things that a farmer might prioritize, right? Because of this distance between this disconnect. And I believe this is where that can be solved, right? You have to have this sort of basic AI education incorporated, whether it's in a pharmaceutical, B-farm, or let's say something in college level, in engineering, in biotechnology, molecular biology or chemistry, everywhere. Having a basic understanding of AI incorporated in during those periods will help these professionals to accomplish more, if I'm right.
Absolutely. That will create a quantum, building block, where every new, doctor coming out, understands the application. Because even if you go into the doctor profession, right, which is the practitioners, right, they have also started adopting and applying AI, You know, they might not know it, but a lot of the software that they are using today, you know, applies, you know, AI. Now, you know, some of the classic ones that we've already known, there is enough material available, you know, is, for example, detection of breast cancer. So there are already tools available which are AI powered, which sort of, you know, help you early detection of breast cancer, right? So now the doctors are already using those tools, but probably they don't know that there is a lot of AI at play behind it to really read and then analyze and then give you a prediction, right? You know, so that's where it has to start, and then, you know, goes all the way up.
So I think we have you have given me so much information, and I am just buzzing out you know, with the new data that you have just transferred. So is there any initiative that's currently happening in the pharmaceutical sector that you might, you know, you might want to mention here? Because I'm not an expert, and I'm from what you have mentioned, I think it's an area that where, like, healthcare. I mean, I've been covering many of the healthcare initiatives. For example, the breast cancer screening. You know, we had a talk with Niramai Analytics founder Geeta Manjunath a few weeks back. So there are those things. Apart from that, what are the key AI-led initiatives that's happening currently in the pharmaceutical sector?
Right. So to be very honest, I won't claim to be an expert as well. This is a new industry for me as well. You know, I've been in this industry for the last, I'll say, 6 months and a little bit more, you know, from a digital transformation perspective. You know, I know that there is definitely a need for all of us to come together as a pharma industry to focus far more on the AI side, you know, to put our energies together, right? While I know, you know, within the pharma industry, one is the regulation, the second is the IP becomes really, really critical. You know, so as a result, there are, you know, silos which get created because everybody is working, you know, on, you know, in patent drug, you know, which is sort of a pre-patent, then in patent, you know, things like that. So that sort of becomes a big challenge. But as far as data and sharing of best practices is concerned, right, on what you really finding as applications from an AI perspective, I think there is definitely, you know, a lot more room for us to collaborate and do much more. There are definitely agencies and organizations which are talking about pharma together, you know, as such, and bringing all of us together from a pharma platform. There are a lot of consortiums available and bodies available which do that. You know, but specifically on AI, I am not aware of, you know, and I might be a little ignorant on this, you know, but this is a great question. I think I also need to go back. But from whatever I've seen, you know, and probed around with fellow CIOs or, you know, across the industry, you know, all of us are of the consensus that there is a lot more scope for us to come together, you know, and then share best practices and do much more, you know, be it on the space of AI, be it in the space of digital transformation itself as an overall, which is, you know, automation and control systems and things like that. So there are lots which is happening, but it's happening in isolation. It's happening in pockets, it's happening in silos, so to say. And, you know, I think this is the right time for all of us to come together and start collaborating.
I personally feel that the challenges to pharmaceutical industry is much more than any other industry. Like, for example, take hospitality and travel, you know, for them, predictive pricing and all those things can be done without much challenge. But considering the sensitive nature, or especially with regards to IP and the regulations, you know, and trials and things like that, the whole idea about responsible AI being very important, and people are talking about algorithmic auditing, I think the whole challenge for pharmaceutical is little more than other industries.
No, absolutely. I think you brought out a very interesting topic of responsible AI, and I think that applies, you know, to the maximum within the pharma industry, right? You know, at what stage do you really, till what extent do you use AI? To what extent do you use your own, you know, mental capability, right? And, you know, how do you really, because finally, you know, it's all data and algorithms, right? One of the reasons why AI is a little slow from a pickup is because even bodies like the FDA, for example, right, they're doing a great job in adopting technology, you know, but at the end of the day, you know, there is always a question to say, can I trust this algorithm alone, right? So you still need some human to sign off to say, you know, that person could have used AI to shrink the process, right? But at the end of the day, there has to be a human who has to sign off on the report, you know. And it is similar here. It is also similar in the aerospace and defense industry. You know, I've worked in the aerospace and defense industry for a while. And application of AI becomes a challenge there as well, right? You know, a very interesting use case, we were seeing there where, it's the FDA here, and similarly on the aerospace, it's the FAA, right, in the US, or the DGCA in India, right? When you look at those, the same thing happens when you start applying AI. Very interestingly, we were told that, you know, the AI algorithm, even if it sort of gets to a 70% or an 80% efficacy levels, right, stop the algorithm from self-learning and going to a 90. And the reason for that was, let's stop it at a certain level, whatever level you want to stop at, 80 or 90, but let it not be a continuous improvement process of self-learning, because that's actually the key thing from an AI perspective, right? But we were told to stop because then the outcomes of that algorithm are not predictable any longer, right? And when you come to regulated industries, be it aerospace and defense or be it pharma, the outputs have to be predictable, right? And so even if it's 70% efficacy of an algorithm, or if it's a 90% efficacy of an algorithm, it has to stay at that constant level, right? And if you're doing any change, then a complete change control has to be taken following the GMP practices, which is a good manufacturing practices, or the GXP practices, and to make sure that, you know, if it's taken from an 80 to a 90, there is a logic behind it, then it's frozen at a 90. So after some point of time, you're not really applying AI, but you're stopping AI from self-learning, but you're freezing at a certain level. So, you know, there are those final and finer nuances of every industry, you know, which go hand in hand with the regulations at the end of the day. And I also think it's the right thing to do, because you don't know, like in the manufacturing process, the whole thing can become a runaway reaction, right? If these, the chemicals are not managed at the right time, and, you know, it's not put at the right time, it can turn into a runaway reaction. You know, we've seen this in our chemistry labs also in grade 11 and 12, you know, suddenly there'll be an explosion because you couldn't really control the reaction, right? You put too much of chemical A into a chemical B, right, at the end of the day. You don't want the same thing to happen on an AI algorithm, right? Where the algorithm starts becoming self-learning and you really don't know what's happened and what is the basis for it, because everything has to be traceable, you know, to the last, last reaction or last algorithm, reaction that really happened, or the data analysis that happened. It has to be traceable back. So the traceability is really important, right? So it's tricky. I agree with you. Sorry for the long answer, but, you know, it's tricky.
I really like your chemistry analogy. I mean, that's the best way to explain it. You know, it just brought me back to my school days, where you had to write what salt you added. You know, you need to trace that properly. And I think you get the mark once you can prove it, right? You know, this is how you identify particular salt. And I think that's very interesting way to look at how to build these algorithms, you know, especially from a regulation standpoint of view. Gaurav, I had a great privilege, I feel like, talking to you, especially, they say, you know, right things happens at the right time. I originally, even though this conversation was supposed to happen on skilling, with the vaccine coming up, I can't feel there's a better timing than now to have this conversation. And it is immensely insightful. You know, there are so many things I couldn't have considered about the cold chain delivery systems and other factors, and I'm so happy that it happened, and I'm looking forward to publishing this. I believe the readers and the listeners has a lot to learn, especially the prospective students out there who wants to have a career, you know, who wants to stand out going forward in pharmaceuticals as well as in AI. You know, I think it's an opportunity also to mix your passions also, if you're interested in data. And in biochemistry, there is a potential out there. It's an immense pleasure talking to you. And I wish you all the best for your new adventure. And I'm sure you will be having a lot of success there.
Thanks a lot, Jeevu. Thanks for having me. Thanks to NASSCOM for having me here. And, a pleasure talking to you.